Now on BBC One, we join David Dimbleby to assess the results of the Walton by-election.
The votes of the electors of Liverpool Walton, who today had the chance to choose between Labour and Militant, being counted at Liverpool University at this moment. A by-election which Labour hopes will see Militant strangled in its birthplace, the Conservatives lose their deposit, and the Liberal Democrats coming in a very poor second, which is not, of course, how the other parties see it. All will be revealed live on this by-election special. Good evening. It's hard to imagine a by-election less overtly about national politics than Liverpool Walton. The only argument in the streets and in the meeting places on radio and television was who was responsible for Liverpool's decline and who could best get it back on its feet. The most ferocious debate being between the Militant candidate, Leslie Mahmood, who was expelled from the Labour Party earlier this year, and Peter Kilfoyle for Labour, the man Neil Kinnock put into Liverpool to clean up Labour's act by pointing out who were Militant members and who should be kicked out of the party. Well, here to talk about the result and its political implications, Kenneth Clarke, Conservative Secretary of State for Education, Jack Cunningham for Labour, Shadow Leader of the House, Alan Beith, the Liberal Democrats' Treasury spokesman, the BBC's political editor, John Cole, and Professor Anthony King of Essex University. And let's just have a look at the result of the last election when Eric Heffer was the MP for Liverpool Walton. He died earlier this year from cancer. We haven't apparently got the figure there, but anyway, we'll come to that in just a moment. In the meantime, we go to Mark Mardell, who's up there in Liverpool, to find out, first of all, Mark, if you could, what the turnout was today. How many people actually voted?
It was well down on last time. It was 56%. Last time it was 73%. That's, of course, quite to be expected that more people will vote in a general election than a by-election. But the turnout is down, and we're expecting the result in probably under an hour's time here. And it does seem that the Liberal Democrats seem very confident, not confident of winning, but that it's going to be a very close result and that they're going to slash Labour's majority. And just looking at the ballot papers piling up behind me, it does seem that there's a lot of votes going on the Liberal Democrat piles.
What would be the reason for that? Because there was a lot of talk earlier on about, and in the polls it came through, that the Liberal Democrats weren't really doing very well.
Yes, the Liberal Democrats throughout, I mean, have been giving us a lot of complaints because they feel that there was a great deal of concentration on the issue of Militant, because obviously that's the most interesting thing that's happening here, and they felt that the media attention in the newspaper and the television was actually driving down their vote, because people were saying, and I've met many people on the street who've said this, and they've also said it about voting Conservative, we're not going to let Militant in, so we're not going to, as we would normally vote Liberal Democrat, but we're not going to do that, we're going to vote Labour to make sure that Militant keeps out. Now, the polls that we had at the beginning of the week showed the left candidate on about 10%, and the Liberal Democrats hoped that that would mean that people would switch back and say, well, there really isn't any threat of them getting in, there's no chance of them getting in, so we can afford to go back to our own party. I think that must have happened to an extent.
But that particular poll showed Labour at about 60%. Are you saying you think that they may come under 50% or so now?
Well, I think it's going to be under that figure. I mean, Labour are, of course, expecting, because of the low turnout, they're expecting a reduced majority. And the left say that, I mean, their claim is that they're going to get between 18 and 20%. Excuse me. That would give them, they say there'll be between 5 and 10,000 votes in their favour. And that wouldn't be too good for Labour either, really, because it would mean that a considerable number of people had opted for the left. I think there's been
We're just seeing a picture of Leslie Mahmood at the moment, looking rather cheerful, as a matter of fact, in the corner of the count there.
Yes, well, I'm not surprised. It does seem that it's possibly going that way. Everybody's making different predictions at the moment, as one might expect, that the Labour Party say that the left are going to lose their deposit. I really don't think that's going to happen at all. But it's not too good for Labour, is it, really, that If they can show that in a by-election where I don't think, because of the high media profile, especially on the local radio, TV and in the newspapers, that there really hasn't been a great deal of confusion. They may call themselves real Labour, but the fact that Peter Kilfoyle and Leslie Mahmood are rather different names, that one's a man, one's a woman, I think there hasn't been very much confusion at all. People do know what they're voting for.
Mark, thank you very much indeed. Well, the Labour is defending there a majority of 23,000 or so, which had been built up by Eric Heffer over a number of years, it was seen as a very safe Labour seat. But now, what about the significance of what's going on? John Cole, first of all, what are politicians at Westminster, and particularly the Labour Party, going to be looking for tonight in this result?
Well, I don't think it's so much in the result as in what comes on after the result. You may remember that Neil Kinnock did very well in opinion polls after the 1985 Labour Party conference, and that was the one at Bournemouth where he took on the left, took on Militant, and made a very strong and brave speech, and that seemed to go down well with the public. Rather, actually, if I may make the comparison, I think John Major has benefited recently by some of his clashes with what Douglas Hurd called the gods and goddesses of his party, because he has appeared to be taking his own line. In 1985, Kinnock appeared to be taking his own line. I think both Major and Kinnock benefit from that as projecting themselves as strong leaders. So the question is, after this by-election, assuming that the results follow either the opinion polls or with the kind of downgrading that Mark has been indicating, I think it's a question of what Labour does about the people who have defied the party line and either campaigned or worked in one way or another against the Labour candidate, whether they have large-scale expulsions or
not. But leaving aside the expulsions and all that for a moment, which I'll talk to Jack Cunningham about as well, will they be able to point to this election, in your opinion, and say the militant business is over? You no longer, as a potential Labour supporter, need to worry about entryism, Trotskyites in the Labour Party or any of that, because they've come out in the open and they've been revealed as men and women of straw.
Well, it's certainly very convenient for Labour that this has taken place in the one area where Militant are notoriously strong. Of course, Militant have pockets, and more than pockets, of resistance in other parts of the country, but Liverpool was the flagship, I think, and if they get a very bad beating in Liverpool, that clearly is not very good for Militant and is rather good for Labour. But of course, if the figures are going to be in these grey zones, every party will use them for their own purposes.
Professor King, you've been looking at the poll, the latest polling and the opinion right across the political spectrum, which we'll be coming to a bit later on, but in terms of what the parties would be hoping for tonight, what do you think we should be on the lookout for?
I think I disagree with John Cole about this. It seems to me that Labour has always had a problem. It needed to get rid of the militant tendency in people on the extreme left, on the one hand. On the other hand, the activity of doing that drew attention to the fact that they'd all along been in the party. And I think the Liverpool Walton by-election has probably, in a small way, been rather bad news for Labour, simply because it's had the effect, the whole campaign, the fact that it got caught up in GBH, the fact that it got caught up in the dustbin men's strike and so on, I think has just drawn attention to the fact that there is something about the Labour Party still, it may be unfair to Labour, that has been switching people off Labour for a very long time. And I think John was saying this in very sort of rational Westminster terms. I think most people aren't all that interested in politics, and some of this just kind of, to repeat unfairly in some ways, rubs off on Labour. Yeah.
I'll bring you in a moment, right, but Jack Cunningham, I think, ought to have first go at that. A problem that's always there, militant in the party, bad news for Labour this election.
I'm very pleased that Militant have come out into the open at last and are fighting under their true colours and not pretending that there's something to do with the Democratic Labour Party. They never were and they never will be. They have been kicked out of the party, and people who have supported them and worked for them will be kicked out of the party. Just they're our opponents the way the Tories and the Liberals are our opponents. They're a different political organisation. We want nothing to do with them. And I tend to agree with Professor King, actually. I don't think people like these people. I don't think they like what they stand for. And it's very important for us in the Labour Party to make a clear differentiation between what our policies are, the way we conduct our affairs, what we stand for, which is a million miles away from the militant tendency. So they've done us a favour.
So you anticipate, as Militant up there does, that there are going to be investigations after this by-election and expulsions from the Labour, more expulsions from
the
Labour
Party? I don't anticipate it. I know it. We have our regional organiser who's been in the by-election full-time. We have a member of the National Executive Committee, John Evans, MP, who's been there full-time. And they will be reporting to Neil Kinnock and to the National Executive Committee on their observations on what has been going on. during this by-election, and it will then be for the National Executive Committee and the Constitutional Commission of the Labour Party to decide what action to take.
Well, more of that later on, and we'll have a report in a moment from Liverpool, and it'll raise several of those points. But from the Conservatives' point of view, there's talk about the possibility of the Tories losing their deposit, and yet Michael Heseltine said in the House of Commons that Liverpool had turned the corner, it was entirely due to the Conservative Party that had done it. Why is there no credit given to your party, if that's true?
Well, Liverpool politics has become very strange, and Liverpool Walton isn't the constituency we would have chosen to have a by-election in, and there's no doubt, unfortunately, our very good young candidate is seen to be rather irrelevant to the result. People weren't voting for him to keep Militant out. And this is a very curious theatre in Walton, with this battle going on inside the Labour Party. And actually,
inside the Labour Party, Ken. They're actually opposing us, aren't they? Outside the Labour Party.
She was inside until 8 weeks ago.
She's outside the Labour Party. She's
every opposing now, every now and again, you shed a few people. She was mainstream Kinnockite Labour.
I wouldn't say she's inside the Labour Party when she's fighting the Labour candidate.
Every now and again, Jack, I think you're up to 80 you've thrown out. The Labour Party's been running Liverpool for some years, very unsuccessfully. These people now fighting against you are inside your party.
You've been governing very unsuccessfully for 12 years.
If you're going to follow, what about the neighbouring Member of Parliament? Still a Member of Parliament, your colleague, taking the whip in the House of Commons, who made a speech, Mr. Terry Field, quite plainly sympathetic to Militant. What about Eddie Loydon? A Member of Parliament takes the whip inside the Labour Party, would not declare himself for your candidate.
Right,
Mr. Parry, I think, was out of the country, another Member of Parliament. This city has been run badly by so-called moderate Labour for several years.
Well, if action was taken against people who were out of the country, Ken, there'd be a lot of people kicked out of the Conservative Party, wouldn't there?
It's no good. You were very solemnly saying how you were sorting things out, Jack. The fact is, within Liverpool, the people you describe as moderates would not be called moderate in most cities in this country.
But Kenneth Clarke,
and every now and again you shed some of these extremists, but the people you're fighting were the mainstream Labour Party. Only 80 have been thrown out so far.
100
The background is a very, very badly run.
Okay, Kenneth Clarke, let's just move.
No one believes that anybody who was a member of the Militant tendency could accurately be described as the mainstream of the Labour Party. That's a grotesque distortion by any test, Ken. That these people are not in the Labour Party. You said there's a row going on in the Labour Party. Leslie Mahmood is not in the Labour Party, and she's not going to be back in the Labour Party.
Alan Beith, you've heard what each side has said, and no doubt there'll be a good deal more about this said in a moment, but do you see this as a genuine and successful attempt by the Labour Party to drive Militant out, or do you accept what is clearly going to be the Conservative line on this, that actually the Labour Party is full of Militant sleepers and they only get them out in dribs and drabs and not on a sufficient scale?
It's a godsend to the Labour Party that they've actually had the opportunity to fight against a Militant candidate in an election. But the mess that Liverpool has got into, and extreme left leadership in Liverpool, was obtained by people voting Labour, by voting in an ordinary mainstream Labour way time after time. They didn't actually vote in a majority for Labour. At the last council elections, the majority of people voted for Liberal Democrats, and it's only the electoral system that produced that odd result. The fact remains that most of these people have been inside the Labour Party for a long time, and I don't remember any announcements coming from Labour Party headquarters, please don't vote Labour in Liverpool, these are not really our people, we don't trust them. And so Labour Party can't escape from the mess, but the best help they've had is having an open Militant candidate against them. But I must say, listening to all this, you'd think that the two most significant things in this election were that there was a Militant candidate and that there was a Conservative candidate. I suspect that those two will come respectively third and fourth in this election. A Liberal Democrat candidate will have an extremely good result.
Why isn't it your seat? You ran the council in Liverpool. You claim to have done it better than Labour under either Derek Hatton or under the new leadership did, and yet in the polls you haven't been doing very well. You may have a bit of a surprise, but you're not thinking of taking it. This is exactly the kind of seat, surely, that you would be normally saying confidently, we're going to take it. You wait. That's what we've been having in by-elections.
Well, wait and see. It had a 20,000 Labour majority. By the way, we've never actually controlled Liverpool in the sense of having a majority on the council. We've been the largest party on a number of occasions, sometimes with both of the other parties.
Proportional representation, in effect.
Oh, we would have done, indeed.
No, but you had a kind of proportional representation.
No, we had a disproportionate under-representation, right. But nevertheless, we sought to make some very valuable changes in Liverpool, introducing building of houses for sale, improving nursery education in the city, doing all sorts of things which I think have helped to ensure that we're extremely strong in Liverpool and that we are the challengers to Labour.
What are you looking for tonight?
an extremely good result. I look at the faces of the people that you've shown in the various shots from the count, and they look pretty cheerful to me.
Well, I thought that was mainly Leslie Mahmood, but still, maybe you've spotted some Liberals as well. Let's just go back now to the count for a moment. There they are, still hard at it, and we're told that this count is going to be quicker than had been anticipated, probably within the hour, as they start sorting the papers into bundles before the count actually begins there in the Students' Union at Liverpool, where the Conservative candidate once stood for the leadership of the union was defeated by a dog, as he admitted rather ruefully, when an Alsatian with spectacles and a funny cap comes in a sports car. Well, anyway, well, we're about to see a bit of that, and so I shouldn't give away too much, because this is Mark Mardell's report on this by-election campaign, not just about the way it was fought, but also about the very important issues that are at stake there in Liverpool Walton.
Which is the furthest south, London, Moscow, or New York City?
Peter Kilfoyle, both a family man and a hard man.
There you go, you'll go again.
He's worked on the oil rigs, in Australia as a teacher, most recently as a Labour Party official. If elected, he's promising a fresh start for Liverpool, something not everyone wants.
His first task was to set about closing the party in Liverpool and organising a witch hunt.
Six.
He never forgets a remark. He never forgets something that's been said in a meeting. Remember, he was always in a position to watch us because he was the official at all the meetings.
Kilfoyle, a bogus Labour candidate who has hijacked the Labour Party, supporting robbing working class families in this city of their only wage earner.
How does it feel to be the real hate figure of the hard left?
Is that what I am?
Yes.
Well, if that's the case, it's a badge I'd wear with pride, because they are people who trade on hate, and they're people who trade on negative emotions all round. The way in which they wage a war of attrition on anybody that disagrees with them, that is not the way of people in Liverpool. And I would set against that the huge amount of goodwill and warmth that I find everywhere I go in Walton, and indeed in Liverpool.
30 years ago, I went to school with me.
The man most likely to be Walton's next MP is a vital cog in the party machine, close to the party leadership.
I'm telling you, you can't play politics with people's jobs and with people's services.
When Neil Kinnock promised to clean Militant out of Merseyside, Kilfoyle became his hitman. As a full-time organiser in Liverpool, he got rid of Derek Hatton and Tony Mulhern. As regional organiser for the North West, he continued the clean-out.
I put them in the same emotional and psychological mould as I would, for example, the Moonies, that they are absolutely committed, but there is that tendency in certain people to go towards sectarianism, whether it be of a political or a religious nature. Their political zealotry doesn't have any substance in reason. I mean, it's a strange phenomenon, but it's a regular phenomenon in all facets of life. But there are also a lot of young people who have been kidded by the cliches which they use, the slogans which they use. And I feel very, very sorry for those, because they're burnt up and used up and spat out by Militant.
The expulsions haven't destroyed Militant and their friends. They've been flushed out into the open on the City Council. They call themselves the Broad Left. Their opponent here, another hate figure for the left, is the leader of the official Labour group, Harry Rimmer. He's trying to balance the books, and the results are obvious. He'd say he's clearing up Militant's mess by making redundancies and considering privatisation. But that's provoked a work to rule that could still turn to all-out strike. When Labour chose Militant's arch-enemy to replace their staunch ally, Eric Heffer, something snapped. Trotsky's preferred tactic of infiltration, burrowing into Labour, went straight out the window.
The decision to stand was taken by members of the party in Liverpool and in Walton, who felt that we had to have somebody who would stand in the tradition of Eric Heffer as a socialist MP, and not as somebody who would carry out cuts and redundancies, allow bailiffs into people's home, and be a pale pink Tory.
Standing in Walton was a risk for the Militant. If they didn't stand, and with many of their supporters and the Broad Left disqualified from the City Council, with a candidate who had been responsible for eliminating many militants from the party. If Militant had not stood in Walton, they would have been regarded as having conceded both the City Council and Walton constituency to the Kinnock Labour Party.
More like the party's history, some would say. If Militant can't hold the past here, they will be humbled. For more than half a century, Trotskyists have been strong in the local party. The key figures in Militant's ruling central committee cut their political teeth in Walton. Labour's never been in any doubt about what the voters' verdict on Militant will be. But the word has gone out. The aim is to humiliate the hard left. And street passion is no match for power politics.
Ask Harry Rimmer. Ask Harry Rimmer.
Let's go. Let's be speaking about the anti-poll fact campaign.
Labour offers new hope and a new start after years of waste and neglect.
The Walton by-election has been a referendum on Liverpool's far left, the result important for the city's peace of mind.
They have been in two minds at times as to what they were getting as a Labour representative. They're in no doubt now.
What matters in terms of Walton people is the standards of services we've been getting from the council. That's a supposedly moderate Labour council backed by Liberals who have produced nothing but higher levels of debt.
In the early days, the media were saying to me, well, you want the militants to do well, don't you? So they'll just split the Labour vote and you'll come through the middle and win. And I said, no, that's not going to happen because they have no support. And two, it would be so bad for Liverpool if that happened, if the militants had a strong showing. It'll be good for Liverpool that the militants will do so badly.
The Liberal Democrats unceremoniously dumped the man they'd picked to fight the general election and hurriedly chose a new candidate, Paul Clarke. While this was going on, he was still sunning himself in Portugal. But the message was clear. In a by-election, this is a winnable seat. Mr. Clarke, a local lawyer and former leader of the Liberal Democrat group on the council, has grown steadily more irate that Militant has been the issue here rather than his realistic challenge to Labour. Life's hard.
Haven't you suffered in this by-election, it seems, on the doors, that people saying, well, we don't want Militant in, so we better vote Labour, play safe this time?
Yes, it's strange, really, that they have, that argument has come across. I was telephoned by a hairdresser in Walton who said that they'd had five customers in that morning, all normally would vote for Paul Clarke, or vote Liberal, and they've said they were scared of letting Militant in.
Liberal Democrats have built their reputation on dealing with cracked paving stones and traffic problems.
This is Mr. Riley from the City Engineers Department. He's come down to answer the queries we had this morning that we couldn't get answered about what...
In this city, they've been thrust from the relative innocence of community politics into the cut and thrust and recriminations inherent in a hung council. Understandably enough, sometimes they vote with the ruling Labour group, sometimes they don't. So in this campaign, they've been taunted for voting with the broad left.
The truth is, in a hung council, you have to vote in numerous different ways to ensure that the policies go through. And we've greatly been offended by Labour's smear campaign that somehow we're allied with Militant. It shows you how desperate they've become in this campaign. It's a bit like saying that if Paddy Ashdown joins Neil Kinnock in the same lobby in the House of Commons, somehow they've formed an alliance. It's a load of rubbish.
Almost as much rubbish as the thought of the Conservatives doing well here.
We might let the Militants in.
No. So
we can face up.
26-year-old Barclay Greenwood, a political lobbyist from Surrey, doesn't get a great reception on the doorsteps.
I didn't think you'd stay long. God, politicians, you.
But he's coped well with the daily contemptuous questions from the press, and in a campaign heavy with recriminations, it was good to find a candidate willing to take and make a joke. You see, the last time he stood for election, he lost to a dog.
If you were a student in an easygoing and good-natured university such as Liverpool University, and your hustings were attended by an Alsatian dog called Muttley, wearing shades and a red waistcoat and driving a smart red sports car which meant beep beep as it entered the hall, who would you vote for? A dog of immense character.
And there was more good knockabout stuff from visiting cabinet ministers who used the opportunity to take a broad swipe at Labour.
This was unfortunate. Miss Mahmood is now being treated as some pariah because she was expelled 5 weeks ago, was one of their colleagues. And Keeva Coombs was the last moderate leader before we had the present chap, Harry Rimmer. None of these characters would be called moderate in any city of ordinary political sensibilities.
Ms. Mahmood would at least agree that she shouldn't be an outcast, in fact that she's real Labour. It is a tag designed to confuse the broad left themselves, who can't bear to face up to the reality that they are now outside the Labour Party. Certainly the voters don't seem muddled.
My daughter was summoned to the court, she was the only one stuck up for her.
So do you think you'll be voting for her?
Yes, and my family.
What about Peter Kilfoyle?
Wash out.
Because of their industrial action, yeah. I'm living in a B&B, and there's no council checks coming out. Uh-huh. So I've got to give £70 out of £79.40 and live on £9.40 through the stupid action of the GMB.
Yeah.
So we've no chance of getting my vote.
Labour blitzed the Anfield ward, where the broad left made one of their gains in the local elections. 17 Labour MPs are in town. More than 100 made the trip during the campaign. But embarrassingly, three hard-left Liverpool MPs didn't bother, wouldn't even say how they'd vote. Most of the helpers here aren't from Liverpool, unlike real Labour's key campaigning couple. Jimmy Hollingshead was chair of the suspended Anfield Labour Party. He's also deputy convener of the GMB's notorious Branch 5. Felicity Dowling was number three in Liverpool's Labour Party during the Hatton era. She was expelled years ago. Both are members of Militant.
No, the Labour Party is the working class party. It's the party of working people. It was set up to fight for homes, for jobs, for a decent education, for the health service. That's where our roots are, that's where we're staying. We're not going to be driven out of the Labour movement. And we will fight for the heart and soul of the Labour Party in this election and in other elections. We think we represent the real traditions of the Labour Party.
But you have been driven out, and you are standing against the official Labour candidate. Even more people will be driven out.
London can try and expel us. The ordinary people in the street still see us as Labour.
One tireless local worker for Peter Kilfoyle sees things rather differently.
An awful lot of people who were members of the Labour Party became so disenfranchised by them and so disheartened at going to meetings and nothing ever being achieved that they left the wards, and of course Militant took over because they were the only ones left. Now the Militant has actually been exposed for what it is, and people can actually see that Militant is going to be expunged completely from the party. We're hopeful and we're sure that those people would rejoin the Labour Party.
The new wave of expulsions will follow this by-election. The orders come from the top.
I won't be entirely happy until, by political argument preferably, the last sectarian, the last entrist, the last Trotskyite, the last abuser of the liberality of the Labour Party has left our ranks.
After all this time, the other parties can scarcely mistake Mr. Kinnock's determination. They can predict failure.
I'm very sceptical that they're actually succeeding in this, because I think that the Labour Party will find fairly quickly there are a large number of sleepers they cannot find, they cannot track down, who have looked at this issue and said, and seen it very much as a testing ground, and said, there's no way that I would raise my head above this parapet.
You don't see the key broad left activists on the top of the Leslie Mahmood bus getting photographed. They're in smoke-filled rooms working out what goes into the next leaflet for her, and they're also in smoke-filled rooms working out how they can ensure that constituency parties are in their control. They won't get expelled, and Labour know that full well.
They may well expel me in the not-too-distant future. I recruited 150 members of my trade union branch to the Labour Party in the last few months. Those people are amongst, some of them are amongst 1,000 people that are being made redundant in the city. They're all of them campaigning in defence of jobs and services within the City Council, and many of them are involved in this campaign here. Now, the Labour Party's got no answer to that.
The party on Merseyside will be a truly democratic, Socialist Party in the very near future. I'm saying to you that the control that was shown that they had over the machinery of the party in the mid-80s has been well and truly broken, and the flotsam and jetsam of militant will be quickly swept up and discarded.
During the campaign, the Labour leader attended the premiere of Paul McCartney's oratorio, a celebration of the city that's given Mr. Kinnock so many problems, and a golden opportunity to show who's boss. But what about the people of Liverpool?
I think it's terribly important that whoever runs a city, whichever party, has a period of control, of stability, where they can be much more concerned with running the city than fighting internecine party battles. Because at the moment, the city of Liverpool has always been sacrificed on the rock of party politics from all sides.
The leader, the council leader, and the would-be MP. A victory for him tonight would be a vote of confidence in them all.
Mark Waddell's report there from Liverpool Walton, and needless to say, the Conservative Party and the Prime Minister have been making great political capital out of this battle going on in Walton throughout the period of the by-election campaign. In questions to the Prime Minister this afternoon in the House of Commons, the subject came up again, and the issue this time was whether Labour would expel any MPs from the party for refusing to support their candidate in Walton, Peter Kilfoyle.
My right honourable friend considered tightening up the law to protect MPs who may be otherwise intimidated from the press. I refer in particular to the Liverpool Echo, which has tried to force the honourable members for Liverpool Garst and Ambrose Green to indicate which Labour Party they're supporting in today's by-election in Walton.
Well, it is certainly an ingenious proposition, Mr. Speaker, and I've certainly followed the by-election in Liverpool with some interest. And I also followed with interest the answer of the honourable member for Liverpool, Garstang, when asked who he'd vote for. He replied, "I am not prepared to answer. A ballot is a secret thing." And so indeed it is, Mr. Speaker. But if the leader of the opposition is serious about militant, he should start by withdrawing the whip from those militant members on his own backbench.
Loudon! Eddie Loudon! Mr. Order, order. Mr. Loudon, Prime Minister, may be aware, ought to be aware, that the problems facing Liverpool are deeply rooted in the policies pursued by the Labour, by this government, the Tory government, for the last 11 years. It's a pity, in fact, that the Tory party didn't pay the same attention to Liverpool as they have done during the last week or two, when they took 62 million out of the coffers of the city of Liverpool, which causes the problems that exist there today.
Problems in Liverpool certainly are deeply rooted over the last 11 years. And which party, or perhaps I should say parties, have been in control of Liverpool for the last 11 years? And why is Liverpool such a unique shambles? It is because the Labour Party, whether under militant control or, as they now like to claim, moderate control, have made a complete shambles of the lives of the people who live in Liverpool.
Now, Jack Cunningham, what is the position about the MPs, like Eddie Loydon we saw there from Liverpool Garstang, like Terry Fields from Broad Green, possibly Bob Parry, who people have said have failed to give support to your official Labour candidate? Is there going to be an investigation of their activities?
I've already said once, and I'm happy to repeat, that John Evans and Eileen Murfin, who is the regional organiser of the party in the North West, will be making a report to the National Executive Committee and the leader of the Labour Party following Labour's victory in this by-election. And it would be against all the rules of natural justice for me to say here and now what the outcome of all that was going to be. And we know, in spite of what they usually refer to as the capitalist courts and other guises, that militant and their lawyers are ready to rush off to the courts at the drop of a hat.
to engage the Labour Party in long and expensive litigation. And I'm not going to give them any excuse to do that now. But the report which is made will cover MPs and other people who've been active in the by-election.
So while you can't comment on the outcome, you can comment on the income, so to speak, or the ingoing information, which would cover all three of those MPs, would it?
Natural justice requires that we have a report, and if an inquiry flows from that report, people are given the chance to explain themselves, and I'm not going to prejudge or preempt any of that.
Would you relish the expulsion from the Labour Party of members who you believe are members of Militant and of MPs who've been sitting in the House of Commons, if they're proved to be members of Militant in the way the NEC requires? Would you actually relish that as clarifying the position of the Labour Party?
Along with Neil Kinnock, since Neil became leader of the party in 1983 and when I first joined the Shadow Cabinet, I have been determined to do whatever I could to expose the Militant tendency for what it is, a dishonest group of people infiltrating and abusing the constitution and policies of the Labour Party, and to drive them out. That remains my position, and it remains the position of Neil Kinnock and the Labour Party and the National Executive Committee of the party and the party conference. We don't want them. They're no part of our approach to politics. We have nothing but contempt for their policies and their behaviour. And if people are shown to be members or supporters of Militant tendency, they will be removed from the Labour Party.
And do you believe it will ever be possible to get them all out? Or is this a process that is going to go on and on? Because Militant, of course, say there'll always be a hard left or a far left in the Labour Party. They won't be able to get rid of us. They'll find a way back in.
They'll always be dishonest people who join all political parties. We've actually seen from time to time, certainly in my career in politics, members of the National Front getting involved in the activities of the Conservative Party. And I can well remember Keith Joseph, now Lord Joseph, refusing to share a public platform in a general election with a Conservative candidate in Stockton, for example, because of his views. So we'll always find small groups, sects and fanatics of the right and the left trying to use the major political parties for their own purposes. It just doesn't affect Labour. It so happens that Militant have been a particular problem for Labour, but what is good about what has happened in Liverpool is, because of the desperation of their position, they've now come out in their true colours, and people have had the opportunity to make a clear choice. I don't think there's any doubt about the choice that the people of Liverpool will have made. They want to be rid of Militant and their dishonest manipulation of the city and the city's finances as much as the Labour Party does. And I think that will be reflected in the vote for Peter Kilfoyle in this by-election.
Well, listening to you is a leading member of Militant, the chairman of the Broad Left, a man expelled from the Labour Party, Tony Mulhern. Mr. Mulhern, you've heard Mr. Cunningham say he has nothing but contempt for the behaviour of Militant, that they're dishonest people acting out of desperation, and that this by-election will show that people don't want you. What do you say to that?
Well, Mr. Cunningham wouldn't he? But one of the grotesque features about the discussion that has taken place at your end is the total absence of any reference to policies. Jack Cunningham and the rest of the Labour leadership have manoeuvred themselves into the grotesque position where they're supporting a candidate who's in favour of compulsory redundancies whilst they're opposing compulsory redundancies nationally. They're supporting a candidate who is in favour of privatisation while they're opposing privatisation nationally. They're supporting a candidate in the shape of Peter Kilfoyle who's in favour of rent increases, who's in favour of using Tory laws against trade unionists involved in legitimate action to defend their jobs. And that, unfortunately, is the grotesque position that a Labour leadership, now find themselves in, arguing about the minutiae of their obsession with a witch hunt instead of dealing with the question of jobs, of services, of providing houses like we did, sports centres like we did, jobs like we did, and fighting the Tory government to get the £650 million back into Liverpool, which they have stolen. I've yet to hear Cunningham or Kinnock or any of the other Labour leaders arguing to get the cash back into Liverpool that has been stolen by the Tories. But that's the main issue for us.
Mr. Mulhern, you're repeating the arguments that have been heard during this by-election, of course, but the question that we've been discussing here, and I want to put to you, is you chose to fight this by-election as real Labour, as you call it, with the militant very strong in it. Do you see this result as a test of militants' strength in that constituency after many years of organising, and one that ordinary voters watching in the rest of the country can say, well, militants had it, or, well, militant is rather more successful than the Labour Party would like to pretend?
No, well, absolutely nonsense. To suggest that militant supporters or the left are going to go away is absolute nonsense. And by the way, 25 Labour councillors have been suspended or expelled. Many of them are not even militant supporters. The District Labour Party was closed down by Mr Kilfoyle after two votes of censure was moved against him, and he didn't even turn up to defend his case. He merely recommended the closure of the Labour Party. Mr Kilfoyle has closed off all democratic discussion in Liverpool, all democratic accountability, and he supports all of the Tory measures which are being implemented by the local council with the support of the Liberals and Tories.
But you're not answering my question. What do you need to get today to hold your face up high in Liverpool Walton and say we really represent the people of Liverpool Walton? What percentage of the vote do you need for that?
The question for us, Mr Dimbleby, was never what percentage of the vote. If we get 10%, 15%, that's a tremendous impact. The question for us was that the people of Walton were entitled to a socialist choice as opposed to a bogus Tory. There is no difference between Mr Kilfoyle, the Tory and the Liberal candidate in this election. He supports all of their policies. In fact, on some issues, he's to the right of the Liberals. And the likes of Jack Cunningham, because of their grotesque short-sightedness, have manoeuvred themselves into a position where they are compelled to defend a candidate who is opposing every single national policy of the Labour Party in relation to privatisation, redundancies, jobs, and all of the other social problems facing the city of Liverpool. They've never once mentioned support for a campaign to get the £650 million back into Liverpool, which has been stolen by the Tory government, which is the root cause of the financial problems facing the city of Liverpool.
Mr Malone, thank you. Jack Cunningham.
Claptrap. Peter Kilfoyle was not acting on his own account, of course. He was the servant of the National Executive of the Labour Party. He had not only the determination, but the guts to stand up to the thuggery and intimidation which was so commonly a feature of the attitudes and behaviour of Liverpool militants. And he is a mainstream Labour Party candidate. He's a man of personal integrity, courage, as I've said. He has my wholehearted personal backing and that of Neil Kinnock. And he's going to be not only an outstanding Member of Parliament for the City of Liverpool, but he offers new hope of a fresh start for the city, because he'll be working not on his own account but with Harry Rimmer, another man of considerable personal integrity and bravery, who is doing a tough job in difficult circumstances, because, and there's no point in disguising it, when they had control of the city, Liverpool brought the city to the brink of bankruptcy. And let me say, before Alan Beith gets too sanctimonious about all this, the Liberals, in their conduct of the affairs of the City of Liverpool, and Sir Trevor Jones, who we saw earlier, didn't do much better. And most recently, the Liberals have actually been voting with militant against Harry Rimmer in the Labour
Party. Hold on a second. I want to bring in Mr Rimmer, but
I
briefly,
think I'm entitled
yes.
to answer that.
But we're going to get a result in them. Yes, there'll be plenty of time after
the
result.
We've never voted for any broad left motion. They, and indeed Labour councillors, have quite often voted for things we have put forward, as we've sought to give Liverpool some sensible administration.
Kenneth Clarke, I just want to put a question to you, because Harry Rimmer, the leader of Labour, is listening, and I want to just come to him before we get the result. On the Monmouth by-election we had here, Chris Patton raised the issue of lies over the National Health Service. I have a suspicion that you're putting what is going to be the line on this by-election this evening, which is that what it reveals is that there are militant people in the Labour Party that they can never get out. Am I right in the line that's going to be taken?
Well, this is a line that's been taken. I think it's what's been revealed by Walton. I mean, Jack very carefully describes the position of the three Liverpool Member of Parliament you asked him about, but it's a hopeless task. The Dave Nellist in Coventry is an open militant sympathiser in the House of Commons. Liverpool isn't the only council in trouble. Look at what's going on in Lambeth. Look what's going on in Camden.
Or Westminster.
Hackney. No, you started barracking me last time, George. It's all right, you've had a very long innings. Jack, sorry. George joined the SDP some time ago. Jack, I'm extremely sorry. The fact is, you've got barracking me every time I mention Lambeth, Camden, Hackney, Islington. Dave Nellist in Coventry, three Labour members in Liverpool. The fact is, you have a deep canker inside the party, and it's come out in Walton. And because we expelled Mr. Mahmood 8 weeks ago, that isn't going to rescue.
Harry Rimmer, the leader of the Labour Party in Liverpool, is listening, I hope, as the count goes on. We're coming fairly quickly, I think, to the result of this. There are some of the candidates. We saw the Conservative and Screaming Lord Such is there, and the Liberal candidate. And in the background there on the right, Peter Kilfoyle, Labour candidate, and Paul Clarke, Liberal Democrat there. But Harry Rimmer is listening to this. Now, Mr. Rimmer, you've been fighting away as leader of the council since Militant was removed from it. I don't suppose you've heard everything that's been said here, but the Conservative line on this is that you'll never get rid of Militant from the Labour Party. That's the thing you've set your heart on doing, but it's not possible to do. And this by-election demonstrates it. There are people who were there only a few months ago who are now standing as anti-Labour candidates. What do you think?
Well, I think we've made a good start on getting rid of Militant. Militant has always been a parasitic organisation on the body of the mainstream Labour Party, with its own agenda, its own set of policies, its own structure, and we found it very difficult to get rid of it. But the process is well underway. I'm satisfied that this result of this election will demonstrate once and for all that Militant tendency out of the Labour Party. They don't represent the Labour Party. They have nothing in common with the Labour Party, really. And we are in the process of ridding ourselves of them once and for all.
How difficult has that process been, and how sharp has the conflict been during the weeks of this by-election between the Labour Party and its opponents in the real Labour Party?
It's been sharp, as you put it, but you must understand we're used to the sloganising. We've just had an example of that from Tony Mulhern, the sort of newspeak that these people use. And we're used to it in Liverpool now, and the people of Liverpool have rumbled it, and I'm sure that the result of this by-election is going to show that their days are literally numbered. They will suffer the fate of all other splinter organisations. They will fade away and die. They're rumbled.
But won't they just come back having, if they have failed in their public attempt to gain support, won't that strengthen the hands of those who say we should just remain in the shadows of the Labour Party as we were before?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear much of that,
if they don't do well in the popular vote, won't they just say our proper place is in the shadows of the Labour Party? That's where we ought to go. I'll come back to Mr. Rimmer, because I think we've got the declaration coming up anyway. Here's the result.
The votes cast in this election are as follows. Paul Clarke,
Liberal Democrat.
Paul Clarke, 14,457.
Liberal Democrat.
Berkeley Jack Rowan Greenwood, 1,155. Peter Kilfoyle,
Labour,
21,317. Edward George Lee Desile, 63.
Leal de Leal.
Leslie Elizabeth Mahood,
Real Labour,
2,613. Lord David Such, 546. And as the returning officer for this election, I declare Peter Kilfoyle duly elected to serve as a Member of Parliament for the Liverpool Walton constituency.
So there's the result. Labour win the seat, 21,000. The Liberal Democrats come second with a very healthy 14,500. Real Labour, that's Militant Mahmood, 2,600. And the Conservatives lose their deposit with 1,155. Let's hear the speech from the winner in Liverpool Walton, Peter Kilfoyle.
Thanks to our magnificent campaign team, with special thanks to my own immediate support group.
But most of all, thanks to all of the members of Walton Constituency Labour Party. Sadly, there are two people that can't be with us tonight, without whom I would not be here, and to whom I owe personally a great debt. And they are the late members of Parliament, Sean Hughes and Mike Carr. Yeah. Sean and Mike both had a vision for Liverpool and Merseyside and for the Labour Party in a national resurgence under a Labour government. I share in that vision, and tonight the people of Walton have shown the imagination to aspire to a society built on cooperation and compassion rather than one destroyed by confrontation and contempt. Liverpool is a city of talents waiting to be tapped, but it's been denied its opportunities by 12 years of managed decline. Disraeli once defined a Conservative government as an organised hypocrisy. I must agree with that definition when I look at what 12 years of Tory government has done. Where there was harmony, they've made a virtue of discord. Where there was hope, they've opened up an abyss of despair. And where there was ambition, they have reduced it to resignation. Remember, too, that without the reaction of the Tories, there would have been no fertile ground for that peculiar excrescence of militant tendency, now happily excised by tonight's results from Tory demonology. Tonight, the people of Walton have sent out a message on behalf of people throughout this land. They are with the Labour Party on its march towards government, sharing its hopes and aspirations for the 90s. And so, I call upon all who would share our commitment to a compassionate and equitable society to join with me tonight in once again, without apology, addressing those famous words to a Tory government. You have sat too long here for any good that you have done. Depart, I say, and let us have done with you. In the name of God, go!
Peter Kilfoyle, the victor there, and now the Liberal Democrat, Paul Clarke, who got 36% of the vote.
Staff for a very efficient conduct of the count. Can I also thank my agent, Mike Storey, and Chris Renard and the by-election team for a superb campaign which they fought on behalf of our party. Can I thank the Walton councillors for their hard work that has produced this stunning result for the Liberal Democrats. And can I give special attention and thanks to David Alton and Paddy Ashdown for their support and help during this campaign. My Lord Mayor, can I also thank the long-term help and support I received from my wife, Hillary, and indeed from my parents for providing me with every opportunity in life. My Lord Mayor, you're well aware that this is a victory for the people of Liverpool. It is a hollow victory for Labour and a stunning result for the Liberal Democrats. My Lord Mayor, it is a shame that Labour people deluded many people, helped by the national media, into thinking this was a Labour militant fight. We knew from the start that militants have no support in this city. This is the day that Liverpool fought back, not just against militants, but against Labour misrule for 8 years in this city. It's a massive thumbs down to the Labour Party in this city.
I thought Labour
My
won.
Lord Mayor, we should also turn to the amazing 2.9% that the Tories have managed to achieve. The so-called party of our government, 2.9% in a major city in their country. 2.9% is the lowest vote that a candidate has received since the First World War in any election, in any by-elections. This is a seat that the Tories held until 1963, and today they have been rejected by 97% of the electorate. That is a government that's on the slide. My Lord Mayor, it is a swing from Labour to the Liberal Democrats of 13%. Neil Kinnock came to Liverpool and said it was a referendum for a future Labour government. He's had his result. Liverpool has said no to a future Labour government. This is a stunning result for Liberal Democrats. It's against the expectations of many, including especially the national media and the television in particular.
The guy's running out.
We are the only party in this country that is in Tory and Labour areas, making advances, making strides, and winning. My Lord Mayor, if I conclude by the quote of an ex-Liverpoolian, Gladstone. Gladstone said, and I'm sure you're aware, you cannot fight the future. Time is on our side. The time for Liberal Democrats is coming.
The Liberal Democrat there, Paul Clarke, who got 36% of the vote. Labour got 53% of the vote,
I'd
and
like
now Leslie Mahmood, Walton Real Labour,
7%, like to thank
just
the
under
7%. Workers in here tonight, the council workers, some of whom may be facing in the future some more redundancy notices and the threat of privatisation by this Tory government. It is quite clear that the Tories are never going to get anywhere in this city. The Tory party is being buried in this city. But what we have seen is a vote by people giving the benefit of the doubt to the so-called official Labour candidate who has posed in pale pink Tory policies, who's conned people, because when the bailiffs come to the front door of the people of Walton, when the redundancy notices are being issued, where will this MP stand? Will he stand with the people of Walton or not? He will stand against them. And I think that we will see in a few years' time that those voters have been conned into believing that a vote for Peter Kilfoyle will mean a Labour government. I don't think you can say it's an achievement to have reduced Eric Heffer's majority from 23,000, because Eric Heffer was a fine socialist who supported public ownership, full-blooded socialism. He supported the fight of Liverpool people against the Tory government, and he got a massive 23,000 majority for that. What we've seen today is that majority being wiped down to 7,000. That is not a victory. That is a disgrace. And if you vote with the Liberals for redundancies, you support bailiffs and sackings and cuts along with the Liberals, then what you get is an increase in the Liberal vote. Real Labour has been going in Walton.
So let's just have a look then at the way the votes were cast in Liverpool Walton. This is the result. Held by Labour, with Peter Kilfoyle getting 21,317. Paul Clarke, the Liberal Democrats, 14,457. Leslie Mahmood, for the Real Labour, the militant candidate, 2,613. The Conservatives, Barclay Greenwood, losing their deposit, 1,155. The first time the Conservatives have lost their deposit since the new rules on a 5% vote, losing your deposit if you were under 5%, came in. Majority of 6,860 on a turnout of 57%, a fairly low turnout. And this is the share and change since the general election in Liverpool Walton. The share of the vote, first of all, Labour on 53%, the Liberal Democrats on 36, Real Labour on 7, the Conservatives on 3, and the change from the 1987 election result, the Liberal Democrats up 15 there, Labour down 11, Real Labour, who didn't exist before, of course, up 7, the Conservatives down 12%. So, Alan Beith, the Liberals in this, you haven't had much to say so far. Your vote's gone up 15%, you've got 36% as against Labour's 53%. It's not a victory. Is it better than you thought you'd do? Worse than you thought you'd do?
I said wait and see. I think it's a superb result. This was the election which was supposed to be a battle between Labour and Militant. Militant, as we prophesied from the start, had no significant support at all. The Conservatives got what I think is the lowest Conservative mainland proportion of the vote anywhere since about World War I. We got 36% of the vote. Labour had a 20,000 majority, which evaporated, and it did not go to Militant. It wasn't split between Labour and Militant. There is huge Liberal Democrat support there, an outstanding campaign by Paul Clarke, who's a very good candidate indeed, with a very good record as a councillor, and I'm absolutely delighted to have such a good result.
Kenneth Clarke, you've lost your deposit the first time since these new rules came in.
Well, that's right. I mean, the election, because of these terrible problems in Liverpool, was a bit of a three-ring circus, and quite obviously, nobody really thought the Conservative candidate, who was a very good candidate, had the slightest chance.
Well, you weren't
turning away from the Labour, but I suspect we had quite a lot of Conservatives vote for the Liberal Democrat, who did very well. Mm. And there was this bizarre problem going on between the two Labour candidates. I mean, so far as our position is concerned, I mean, Walton is irrelevant. The more significant thing is the national polls, which show we're not far behind again. We've come back again. There are two local government by-elections. We won tonight. We've had a gain from Labour in Blackburn, which is Jack Straw's seat. We've had a gain from the Social Democrats in Malvern. And
You're beginning to sound like a Liberal politician. That's what they always say. We've had a local by-election result.
Tonight there have been some local government results. We've lost one seat, we've gained two. The national polls are showing us back in contention. In Walton, unfortunately, nobody voted Conservative. A lot of people voted Liberal. They did very well. Alan's quite correct to try to rid Labour of this terrible legacy of Labour misrule, and this absurd internal battle goes on inside the Labour Party between the two candidates they had.
Jack Cunningham, what is the significance of 6.6% for Walton real Labour as opposed to 53% for the Labour candidate?
I felt Kenneth Clarke have an uninterrupted contribution there simply because he sounded more ridiculous the longer he went on. This is what we've just seen. There's two politicians who've been resoundingly defeated trying to claim victory. Well, Peter Kilfoyle's got more than 50% of the vote. He's got more votes than all of the candidates put together. We thrashed the militant tendency, which is, I think, a good thing not only for Labour, but for British democratic politics generally. It's very good news for the city of Liverpool. Since the local elections in May, when the Liberal Democrats got 39% of the vote, they've lost a share of the vote. Labour has increased its share of the vote since the local elections in May, which shows that we chose the right candidate, we argued on the right policies, and what the result shows is that the Conservatives are irrelevant so far as the people of Liverpool are concerned to the future of their city.
What about militant and the Labour Party?
I've made my position, I think, clear.
On expulsion,
David,
but what about the effect on support for militant among the kind of young people who were out on the doorsteps in Liverpool, who were given a sort of vision of how socialism should operate by militant?
Peter Kilfoyle got 21,000 votes and the militant got 2,500 votes. That's 10 to 1. They were talking about having great strength among the people of Walton. What this result demonstrates is they're as dishonest in those claims as they are about their policies and their intentions in terms of what they want to do for the city and its people. The militant has been totally exposed for what they are. People who didn't even have the courage to stand under their own title in this by-election, but tried to usurp the name of the Labour Party. I'm delighted that they've had such a crushing and humiliating defeat in a place which they've always prided themselves on as being one of their strongholds.
We'll come back to Liverpool in a moment and we'll talk to the winning candidate up there, but John Coe, perhaps you want to say something about the result, but then perhaps you would also want to say something about today's opinion polls and what's going on nationally. Because Liverpool, as I said at the very beginning, is a very special case,
It's a very special case for the reasons Kenneth Clarke mentions, that the Conservatives were, what we're interested in nationally is the battle principally between Conservative and Labour, but with a significant Liberal Democrat contribution to it one way or t'other. What I would like to talk about is the national position. I mean, we have this Daily Telegraph poll tomorrow morning, which confirms the trend of the last two or three polls, suggesting the Conservatives are pulling up on Labour again, but still 3.5 points behind. And I think this is a very interesting stage in the fortunes of this government. I mean, quite clearly, the Conservatives have taken a decision at the centre of the party, that the Mrs. Thatcher's decision not to continue in the House of Commons and the row between Mr. Heath and Mrs. Thatcher gave them an opportunity to try to prove that this is a new government. And there's a very conscious decision taken on that, and many Conservative leaders, the party chairman and others, attribute their success to the feeling that people think this is a new government now. And of course, what Labour is fighting back against.
Let's just have a look at these actual figures with Tony King, and then we'll come back to you, John, for your version of them. Here are the figures that the Daily Telegraph Gallup poll has for tomorrow. First of all, the party share, a margin of error of 3% on this. Party share, Labour 40.5%, the Conservatives 37%, the Liberal Democrats 17%.
Yes, and what's interesting about that is that for a long time, throughout 1990, you had a position in which the Conservatives were miles behind in the opinion polls to Labour under Mrs. Thatcher. Mr. John Major becomes Prime Minister, and just about overnight, the Conservatives go into a pretty comfortable lead. Then in May and June, things begin to go bad for the Conservatives, and now we see the Labour share holding up pretty well, but the Conservatives coming back really quite strongly.
Let's see the next one, which is on divisions in the party, because this is rather relevant to what you were saying, John, about perceptions of the Tory party. This is the view about how divided the parties are. First of all, in March, the red corner, Labour, 49% believing them to be divided, and 25% in the blue corner believing the Conservatives to be divided. In June, the figure changes, and you get Labour goes to 39 and Conservative go to 61, and in July, to take the last one, Labour goes to 45 and the Conservatives to 70% now believe, is that right, the Conservative Party is divided?
Absolutely, and that's absolutely wonderful in a number of ways. One, we're so used to the idea of people thinking of the Labour Party as being divided, and here we have far more people now thinking the Tories are divided. But the other wonderful thing about all this is that the Conservatives have recently been making a modest recovery in the polls, as we saw a moment ago, yet according to these figures, it's quite clear that people think the Tory Party is very deeply divided. What's going on here?
What do you think is going on?
Well, I mean, I think it's a matter of some finesse what the Conservative leadership is at, but I think they're making a virtue of necessity on the divisions, that they've decided to draw a line under the Thatcher period. I mean, I was astonished when one senior minister said to me today that Ted Heath and Margaret Thatcher were looking like Darby and Joan. Now, you know, this quite clearly, this would not have been said before Mrs. Thatcher announced that she wasn't carrying on in the House of Commons. And they're going to try to make, they think John Major has to assert himself as a new man, and they're determined to make the opportunity to do that.
Tony King, let's just see the other two graphics, which are on economic optimism and the handling of the economy, and see what they show. Perhaps you'll comment on this first of all, economic optimism.
These are responses to a question that Gallup asks in all of its surveys. How do you think the financial situation of your household will change over the next 12 months? And what's been done in this graphic is to take the proportion who think that the financial position of their household will improve over the next year and subtract from it the proportion who think that their position will deteriorate. And as you can see, if we go back to last March, there was a high ratio of economic pessimists to optimists. Very gradually, the climate improved through April, through May. By that time, there were more optimists than pessimists. And now, going back to June, we find already a little bit more pessimism beginning to creep in as unemployment goes up. Very sharply. And then when we get to the latest survey, we find another of the wonders of this poll. The Conservatives are pulling back, as we saw earlier, yet at the same time, the ratio of economic pessimists to optimists has gone up really quite substantially. Now that's odd on the face of it. One might just add that that may portend somewhat harder times for the Conservatives over the summer, because there's some reason to think that that's a sort of leading indicator, that when you see those kinds of figures coming out, you look for the government to be in some trouble a few weeks afterwards.
Except for the contradictory evidence of who you think gets the economy running better, which is the other bit of information that Gallup has. Let's just see those figures.
Yes.
The handling of the economy.
Notice that the figures we were looking at a moment ago had to do not directly with politics, but what people thought was going to happen to them over the coming 12 months. Now, this question has to do with the relative competence of two different political parties, the Tory and Labour, to handle the economy. It's a question, incidentally, that Gallup's been asking ever since 1964. And what you see there is that at all of those points in time, last autumn under Mrs. Thatcher, under Mr. Major this year, up to last month, that the Conservatives were ahead on the economy. But last autumn and last month, only by 4 percentage points. And that's actually a lower lead than the Conservatives had on that question when the Conservatives lost the general election of 64.
Fine. We'll come back to some of those points in a moment and talk to politicians about them. We go up to Liverpool now to hear from the victor of tonight's by-election.
Peter Kilfoyle, you're the new MP for Walton, but with a reduced majority. You can't be too pleased about that.
I think it's perfectly natural that we've had a much reduced turnout, which is always the case, obviously, in a by-election compared to a general election. And it's not a bad turnout, having said that, for an inner-city seat. I'm not in any way displeased to be elected the Member of Parliament for Walton. I think your questions ought to be addressed towards the Tories, who I believe may have had the worst results since 1918. And, of course, we've disposed of the myth of militant once and for all.
Have you really disposed
of it? Absolutely. They hold no mandate for people in Liverpool, despite a campaign based on misinformation, using Labour Party colours or whatever. They may have fooled a few people, they haven't fooled that many.
What did you think of their campaign?
That's their problem. It had no effect on the actual election result.
But nevertheless, there was 7% of votes went for the most, not a very large proportion, but you know, people were voting. There could have been no confusion about what policies they stood for.
Look at the independent analysis that was done earlier this week, there were people who said they were going to vote for what's laughingly described as real Labour, but who were also, in actual fact, very much opposed to militants, and they were opposed to the policies of the so-called broad left in the city. I'm not too bothered by that.
They say they'll be back in control, the broad left will be back in the control of the council within 2 years. Are they going to do that?
They would say that. Absolutely not.
But it does seem that what's going to happen? You think they're going to be wiped out in the council elections?
Well, the truth is, Mark, you've all come here, all the media have come to make a story about militants. Militants are not an issue. They are disposed of. The real issue is that the Labour Party has come through with a bang. We've disposed of the Tories. The people of Walton have put their faith for the future in the Labour Party and the Labour government. That's the real story.
But the Conservatives say about militant that they are still within the Labour Party. I was talking to somebody, a well-known militant who you will well know, said he recruited 100 people to the party.
That's entirely up to them who they recruit to their party. They're not in the party. The fact of the matter is they are outside of the party. They're a separate political party. I don't think they're very relevant. But of course, they're perfectly entitled under any Voltairean principle to do as they see fit. And we defend their right to do that. What we don't defend is their right to enter and subvert the Labour Party.
What about Terry Fields? He didn't come and campaign for you. You're going to be sitting next to a militant sympathiser in Parliament.
No MPs come and campaign. The invitation was open to many, but over 100 quality MPs came into this campaign and worked for me, and I'll be eternally grateful to them.
They came from all over England, didn't they?
They came from Liverpool as well, remember?
Yes, but he didn't even cross the border into Walton.
But that's his problem, not mine. I'm sure his members will take note of his inactivity.
You've expelled people for being militant supporters.
Never expelled anybody.
The Labour
Party National Executive has exercised its rights and its duties under the rules and constitution of the party to maintain the integrity of the party.
Absolutely, but you've supplied the evidence to the NEC. Now, what about people like Terry Fields, whose views are well known? I mean, why go for the councillors up here and not for MPs?
It's absolutely a matter for the National Executive, if and when they receive complaints and they receive evidence, to take whatever action is necessary. My own personal view is that regardless of who it is, people have to maintain the rules and constitution of the party. I've never wavered from that.
Thank you very much indeed, Peter.
Thank you.
Well, that was Peter Kilfoyle, who was the victor for Labour there with over 50% of the vote. And the whole question, of course, still to come of what will actually happen to militant and whether they have been trounced. But in a moment up there, we're going to be able to speak to the militant candidate who got, for her, a very disappointing just under 6.6% of the vote. You heard Tony Mulhern earlier on saying they hope to get 10 or 15%. And I should just say one thing about the militant candidate, Leslie Mahmood. I asked her a question during this campaign, whether she would accept this vote today, as a judgment of the people of Liverpool Walton on militant. And she said yes, she would. And she said that tonight she'd stick by that. She wasn't going to cry foul. She was going to treat what was decided by the voters as a fair judgment on what militant stood for in Liverpool. Let's go up there and join her with Mark Mardell.
Well, Leslie Mahmood, you must be disappointed with that result.
Well, I don't look very disappointed. I think what we've achieved in 3 weeks, the establishment has thrown everything at us. We've had a campaign of abuse and intimidation by everybody, the establishment, the media, the Labour Party Dirty Tricks campaign. We've stuck to the issues of redundancies, poll tax bailiffs. We've set the agenda. We've put socialism on the agenda in this election. What Labour has achieved in this election, official Labour, is squandering the inheritance of Eric Heffer.
But the point was being made in the studio, which you obviously couldn't hear, that you said at a news conference to David Dimbleby that you would accept the verdict of the people of Walton. Do you accept their verdict?
Well,
thumbs down.
We've accepted the verdict of more people who've now joined Walton Real Labour than the official Labour has. We've accepted the
7%.
Verdict of people who've come to the doorstep. They've given Peter Kilfoyle a benefit of the doubt for a Labour government, but I don't think everyone has realised yet that they voted the pale pink Tory policy, support for privatisation, support for bailiffs on the poll tax, support for redundancies. Peter Kilfoyle has hidden his policies through this campaign.
You said you'd accept the verdict of the people.
It takes more than one election to do away with socialism in Liverpool and in Walton. I think what you've seen is the official Labour Party cannot claim anything except that they've squandered Eric Heath's majority. They've reduced their majority to 6,000. They haven't encouraged Labour voters to go out and vote. Many people have stayed at home. Our fight goes on. We will be back in control of the council. Socialism is on the agenda and has dominated this agenda.
But isn't it a defeat for those of you in the broad left who are militant supporters, not just in the size of the vote, but because you're now out in the open? You've always believed in working within the Labour Party. Now you're a separate party. Well, just said you're recruiting people.
Neil Kinnock, we're not a separate party, but Neil Kinnock has put us out of the party. This split is of Neil Kinnock's choosing, and look at the result. They've allowed, by voting with the Liberals, voting on redundancies, supporting Liberals and doing Liblab deals on cuts in the council, they've increased the Liberal vote in Walton, and that is a disgrace. What we have shown is that we've stood for the policies of Eric Heffer. We've only been going for a few weeks and we've achieved miracles. We've totally dominated this by-election. We could not lose by standing, and we'll continue to stand, and socialism is on the agenda still in Walton. We won't be buried. The left have been so-called getting buried for years. We haven't been buried yet. We won't be buried by this.
Thank you very much indeed, Liz Mahmood.
Well, now, John Cole, we go back now to the general political scene. And first of all, you were talking about this change in the polls, and we saw the figures that Tony King produced from tomorrow's Daily Telegraph Gallup poll, showing a fairly sharp narrowing again of the gap between the two parties. What's Labour going to make of this?
Well, clearly they're not encouraged by it, because they were doing very well just a month ago, and there's been a pulling back from that. But what they're taking comfort from is something Tony King mentioned earlier, which is that their vote has remained remarkably consistent, usually above 40% over the past 12 months, I think I'm correct in saying. And they feel that, unlike in the 80s, which were a dead period for the Labour Party, they have held on to their own vote. And then what's happening to the Conservatives is that they're pulling back some of the votes nationally from the Liberals. But Labour feels that as long as the Liberal vote is around this area in the 17 or so on, that they are taking more potential Conservative votes than they're taking Labour ones. And they say that they can form a majority Labour government with 42% in a general election, though some of them expect to get rather better than that. And the point that Tony was on just before we went back to Walton about the economic attitudes. I mean, Labour obviously is putting a lot of faith in their belief that the recession isn't going to come right as quickly as the Treasury hopes in the second half of this year or the very early months of 92, and that therefore the economic optimism will reduce, and that tiny gap of 4% 1 month, but I think 9% in the very latest figure, which we didn't show, between the Conservatives and Labour will narrow further, and that they will have a 1963-64 situation when people preferred Harold Wilson as an economic manager to the Conservatives. Now, that isn't true yet, and the Conservatives are putting a lot of contrast between what was happening in 63-64 and what's happening now.
I mean, the interesting thing is that figure is going away from Labour again.
Well, it's moving both ways, isn't it?
It was at 4.4, now it's going to 9.
But it was 24 before that, and no. It was 16. I mean, they're all over the shop, frankly.
Let's deal with the other issue, which is the position of Major as a leader, which is clearly very significant. And we've got figures on that Tony King has. Let's just have a look at this one, for instance, which is the view of the electorate on Major and his views on Europe.
Well, the Gallup poll simply asked people straightforwardly, do you trust John Major to look after Britain's interests in Europe? And the results were really quite striking, that majorities in all political parties, no fewer than two-thirds of the total electorate, said yes, they did. And I think it's worth remarking about that Europe, to a considerable extent, this hasn't always been recognized, is an issue on which people take their cues from politicians they trust. At the time of the 1975 referendum, you could tell that the European side was going to win, that the yes people are going to win, just by looking at the politicians who are on the yes side and the no side. And this, I think, is very helpful to the Conservative Party in its handling of the European issue inside the party, to have John Major so well respected.
What about this slightly curious question, at least I think slightly curious question, whether Mr. Major is doing the best in difficult circumstances, or whether he's a weak man unable to give a clear lead to the party?
Oh,
70% saying he's doing his best.
That question has a very straightforward origin. Both people in the Labour Party and a lot of Mr. John Major's critics within the Tory Party have been saying that he's a weak man, that he's a ditherer, that he can't make up his mind, that over the poll tax it took weeks and months to do what should have been done in days. So we simply asked people straightforwardly which of two statements did they think was nearer the truth, that he was doing the best that anyone could in difficult circumstances, or that he was a weak man, unable to give his party a clear lead. Nobody involved in preparing the question had any idea what the answers were going to be, and Mr. Major really comes out of it very well. He has clearly not seen the way a lot of Labour politicians, but also a lot of Tory politicians, see him.
Well, now, let's bring the politicians in who have to face all these figures that pour out day after day. Jack Cunningham, you were quoted this week as saying that you weren't jumping off Westminster Pier yet, suggesting that you didn't really like the way that the figures were going.
Well, if we take the Gallup poll, which we've been talking about, at least which Tony and John have been talking about, in March, Labour had 41% in Gallup, and we've got 40.5% now. In March, the Conservatives had 37, they've got 37 now, and the Liberals had 17.5, and they've got 17 now. What happened to Gallup was it was very constant in March, April, May. In June, the Tory share dipped after their disastrous performance in Monmouth and the hysteria which they got worked up in. And the Liberal share of the vote went up. And now, in July, it's gone back to the steady state. So Gallup poll throughout the first half of this year has been pretty constant with Labour in a small but significant lead of three. It's varied from about 3 to 4 percentage points, and tomorrow's poll confirms that position. And if we take the Gallup as compared with the two polls last weekend, it actually is a better result for Labour tomorrow than last weekend's polls were, Murray and the other poll. So what we are seeing is that June apart, where Labour's share of the vote has been robust at above 40% all the way through this year, the Tories slipped a little bit in June and they've come back to their position before that. Now, what this means is that Labour is maintaining a small but significant lead over the Conservatives. Naturally, we'd like to see it to be bigger than it is, but it's good enough for us, and if the Tories are confident they're doing well, let's put it to the test and have a general election.
Kenneth Clarke, are you busy, as John Coe said, enjoying establishing in the mind of the voters that you're no longer a Thatcherite party, but a Major party, and you don't actually mind the public recognising this and seeing a marked difference in style and approach?
Well, I think seeing the establishment of John as a political leader, with the public getting used to him and trusting him on Europe and believing he's doing the best that anyone could do in the difficult circumstances, is a very great asset. And I think it explains one of the curiosities of the poll that Tony King was talking about, that the party did badly in June in the polls and we were perceived as divided, which isn't too surprising because the two former prime ministers appeared, not for the first time, to be having a very public disagreement on Europe. Now, when they were polled, there have been other polls showing that not many members of the public particularly agreed with either Ted Heath or Margaret Thatcher on Europe. So when they're asked, are they divided? Well, we are divided when two leaders appear to be fighting. But when you ask, who do you trust to handle Britain's affairs in Europe, John Major's position, in a way, has actually been strengthened by that experience. With the result, as Jack just said, we're back very nearly where we were before. The blip that put us a long way down was a temporary thing, and I believe, to show us really pretty well neck and neck, I think the May local government election showed, the parties were pretty neck and neck nationally at this time, before the recovery of the recession has got underway, I think is a pretty good position to be in, given we've got the best part of 12 months to go, if we judge that to be correct, before the next election comes.
You predicated all on economic recovery, because you're behind now and you think the economic recovery will give you the extra points.
I think plainly the position of the government improves as economic recovery takes place. I think those questions about people's optimism and pessimism about the economy are very relevant to elections, and we've got a long way to go before this parliament is up, as it happens. I've been saying for 18 months now, so I think we're probably a full term government, I don't know, but for an opposition party like the Labour
Party,
have
to be,
to see us as close as this, when the circumstances, I think, are bound to get more favourable for the government over the next 12 months, I don't think, I'm sure Jack won't jump off Westminster Pier, but frankly, They're not in a very good position. And the main thing that's been revealed is the events of June, that 10-point lead, the momentary belief the public had that Mr. Kinnock might be going to win, that Mr. Kinnock and Mr. Kaufman might be handling affairs in Europe. All that was a temporary blip, and we're looking back as a calm and steady state again.
Alan Beith, you have this unnerving experience of a surge of support which from the Conservatives, which led to headlines about Labour being 10 points ahead of the Tories. What had actually happened was Tory intended votes had moved to you, and now they seem to be coming back, leaving you in a poor position for an election.
Poor position? We've got a very comfortable 17% in opinion polls. When we actually have real votes in ballot boxes, we find ourselves getting 36% in a seat with a massive Labour majority. Incidentally, John Cole talked about a majority Labour government. There would be no chance of a majority Labour government with the sort of swing from Labour to Liberal Democrats which we've seen in Liverpool tonight.
Now, but what about on 37, 40.5 and 17?
Well, 17 is the sort of figure that we ran at for a long time in our alliance days. We're back to the level of strength
we had. That won't
prevent. But if you allow me to finish answering the question.
Let me just take the cephalological point. On the figures that you mentioned, 37, 40.5, 17, would there be a Labour government or not?
I don't think so, no.
Labour were claiming, I was reporting, as Alan will remember, what Labour were claiming, and they say they can have a majority government on 42% if that is all they get, though they claim they will get more, obviously.
And if I can finish what I was saying, one bit of poll that you didn't quote was the bit about what people think about who should be the Prime Minister. And Paddy Ashton comes out with 20% thinking that he, of the three, should be Prime Minister, which is only slightly below the figure for Neil Kinnock, who has a much larger party base. What I'm saying is that we're in a very good and steadily improving position, and the Liverpool result tonight has further demonstrated that.
I should say there are acres of the opinion poll that we didn't quote. We didn't deliberately keep that out. But anyway, let's go back for a moment now to Liverpool Walton, here from the Liberal Democrat, who came second there, Paul Clarke.
Paul Clarke, a very good result for you. You must be
very pleased. Yes, we're delighted. It's a stunning result for Liberal Democrats. We've had a 13% swing against Labour. And this is an election where Neil Kinnock came along and said this is a referendum for a future Labour government. Liverpool people have said they don't like the idea of a future Labour government.
Now, what actually happened? You've doubled your showing from the opinion polls that were out earlier this week.
Yes, our great problem was that the media tried to portray this as a Labour militant fight. And we knew all along that militants had no chance. BBC and TV in particular would always portray it as a Labour militant fight and would not talk about the issues of this by-election. Final 3 days, the issues were talked about and there was a massive surge towards us. This election took place in about 3 days' time. A Labour majority would have been slashed even more and maybe we'd have won this.
So it's all our fault, is it? You'd be the MP if it wasn't for the BBC, would it?
The media throughout, and BBC TV in particular, have not wanted to talk about this by-election. I noticed that Leslie Mahmood was interviewed second, even though she got a couple of thousand votes, and we come on third. There has been particular emphasis just on the Labour militant fight rather than the by-election issues in this case. And there are so many issues in Liverpool that need talking about. We are delighted with this result. This has confounded all the pundits, all the polls. The poll came out saying 18%, we've got 36%. There's a swing against Labour in this city. Liverpool people have said they've had enough of Labour.
Don't you think militants are a significant issue in this city?
Militants are a significant issue within the Labour Party. Liverpool is not a city of militancy. It's a city of decent, good people who restored the pride in Liverpool tonight by the derisory vote for militant.
What do you think that they claim that they're going to be back on the city council? Do you think that's going to happen, or do you think they're going to get
wiped off? A load of nonsense. They're in real trouble now, and so are Labour. People today, throughout the area, that's why Labour's majority from 23,000 has been slashed. We are the only party, both in Tory areas now and Labour areas, making advances where it counts, and that's in the ballot box. I'm delighted with this result.
Thank you very much indeed.
Some people thought that the best contribution to the by-election was made by Screaming Lord Sutch, who wanted, as his policy, to rebuild the cavern in Liverpool, the Beatles' old home, and have a flood of tourists coming there, which indeed they might well have done. But anyway, we won't be interviewing him, but we are just going to fair interview the Conservative candidate, who lost his deposit with just over 1,000 seats, Barclay Greenwood, who's just arrived on the gallery. I don't know if he's got a microphone with him. Let's hope he has.
Barclay, a terrible result for you, isn't it?
No, it's not a terrible result. I have to say, to start with, it was an appalling result for Labour.
whichever way you look at it, Labour supporters did not turn out in the numbers that were expected to
Labour heartland.
Now, the reason for that was because an awful lot of people knew that it was pieces of government legislation which are helping the city. It has been supposedly moderate Labour that has run the city council, and people were not prepared to vote Labour because they do not believe that Labour's record in the city has been good.
Well, Labour didn't get what's possibly the worst Conservative result this century, certainly since 1918.
I think most of our result can be put down to very strong tactical voting. And I was very aware as I went round the doorsteps that the poll results earlier this week had become, in a sense, self-fulfilling. People simply didn't believe that we will be able to beat Labour, and they voted Liberal as a protest vote against Labour in the hope that they could get Labour out of this constituency.
But they didn't vote Conservative. I mean, Walton used to be a Conservative seat back in 1964.
I accept that, but I think that people looked at the situation as it stood. They didn't like Labour. They wanted Labour out. Labour's majority was very substantially cut tonight. They looked at the possibilities of Conservatives being able to win the seat and thought we wouldn't be able to do it, and they decided to vote tactically. A lot of people were apologising to me on the doorstep, who normally vote for Conservatives, and saying, look, very sorry, we won't be voting for Conservative this time because we think we want to vote Liberals to try and get Labour out. But the other point that they made too was most of them didn't really believe that Liberals had the ability to do much good in the city either.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Well, tactical voting kept Tories out and made them lose their party. Last brief word from each of you. Perhaps you'd like to follow your own candidate.
Well, I think quite obviously people did vote Liberal who wanted to keep the Labour Party out. He's a very good candidate. And I suspect the electorate of Walton did calculate he wasn't likely to win. And given this confusion in the Labour group, they voted for other people.
Helped by Geoffrey Archer, who said there was no hope of it.
Well, Geoffrey turned out to be right. I mean, the main news tonight is those national polls. The main news tonight is what's happening nationally. And I think Walton is just part of the tragic story of Liverpool. The Tories aren't totally irrelevant to Liverpool. The mess with the refuse service is being sorted out by compulsory, competitive tendering. Adopted because of the by-election by the Labour Party, it's Conservative policy which they're opposed to nationally in every other city. So they're sorting it out with Tory measures, as the militant candidate quite correctly said. And nationally, we're doing much better than we were a month ago.
Alan Beith, last brief word.
A superb result. We're really on the move. It's far better as ever than the polls show. We've confounded the pundits yet again, and poor Clarke and all our councillors in Liverpool will carry on fighting to get a better future for that city and its people.
Jack Cunningham?
I hope people watching now have actually seen the result, otherwise they'll be somewhat confused as to who's actually the winner in this by-election. I'm delighted for Peter Kilfoyle. I congratulate him warmly and the Labour campaign team. I'm particularly pleased for the majority of the people of the city of Liverpool, who will be delighted that militant have been humiliated in this by-election. And I agree with Kenneth Clarke, actually. Although by-elections are significant, what is most significant is what's happening nationally. Labour maintains a significant lead in the opinion polls. And as the OECD report has shown just 24 hours ago, our economy, regrettably, is in desperate trouble. Britain's bottom of the league after 12 years of a Conservative government. And we're in the depths of a bitter and damaging recession for the second time during their period of office. Those things, above all else, are going to determine the outcome of the general election, and that will be a Labour victory.
John Cole, at Westminster, will MPs quickly forget the colourful and Machiavellian doings of Liverpool Walton and be looking at a broader picture, or is this going to have some effect?
No, not very much effect. Obviously, the aftermath in the Labour Party, the expulsions that take place will cause and be used by each party for its own purposes. But I think what is happening nationally, because the polls are as close as they are, because John Major's got his tail up a bit now after his performance in Europe, and the Labour Party would say the exposure he got in Europe because he's been more prominent, because Labour are running a new campaign practically every day, because the Conservative senior ministers are meeting at breakfast time every morning to plan their strategy, we're going to have politics going full blaze right through the summer break. The Liberal Democrats will join in as well. Nobody will stop at all. I personally am going off for some holidays in the north of Ireland, but everybody else will be going full blast right through the summer. Whether the electors can manage to keep interested until next April, May or June remains to be seen, but we do our best.
John, thank you very much. Neil Kinnock, leader of the Labour Party, has just gone on record saying it was a fine by-election for a united Labour Party. We didn't have time to get round to the doings of Liverpool over the years, though Tammany Hall has prevailed for a long time under other Labour parties, long before militant turned up, and under the Conservatives. It was Bill Deeds, writing in the Daily Telegraph, a distinguished Conservative columnist now, who talked about the former Conservative leader Archibald Salvage teaching Derek Hatton, a militant that is, every trick in the book, and saying that he, as a young journalist, had been sent up to Liverpool to investigate why the Conservative Central Office was barred from going up to Liverpool and addressing the Conservative Party there in Liverpool. So it's the same thing, only the other way around. Anyway, from all of us here in London, I was going to say in Liverpool Walton, after that result and Labour's win with over 50% of the vote in Liverpool Walton, good night.